1 Peter chapter 1, start with verse 3, says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Ooh, I like that. You know that when Jesus died, there was no hope. When He rose from the dead, there was great hope. "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you." There's two inheritances we get. One's in heaven, one's here. We got part of our inheritance here. Part of it's reserved for us in heaven. Verse 5, "Who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time." Notice that statement there. Who are kept by the power of God. Okay? Notice that. How many of you would like the power of God in your life?
Amen.
It's got to be good if it comes from God. It's got to be awesome if it's power. So the power of God, we are kept by the power of God. What does that mean? We're kept safe, we're kept healed, we're kept well, we're kept successful, victorious, safe. We're kept by the power of God.
Thank you, Lord.
Through faith.
Amen.
And that's what we're talking about again tonight is faith. We're talking about getting the things of faith in our soul so that we can walk step in step with God and His Word and then have Him involved in our life.
Amen.
So we're kept by the power of God, and that's wonderful. Almost every single believer in the world would admit that God has power.
Yes.
This scripture says we're kept by that power, but only through faith.
Right.
That means you must believe that you're kept in order to be kept.
Right. Amen.
It's one way to look at it. Now, in context, this scripture is saying, kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. So, in the specific sense of salvation, that's what this context is, that you are kept by faith or by the power of God through your belief for salvation that you'll realize on that day.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory.
And so, for the rest of your life, you're going to be kept by the power of God through your faith.
Hallelujah.
And that makes sense. We understand that as our eternity continues and the veil gets closer and closer for our departure into it, we are kept by faith. So we're never going to lose our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior, right?
Right.
So that's what this context is kind of really saying. However, in any context like this, you can find spiritual principle that can be applied to all sorts of arenas of life.
Yeah.
And that's what you find here. So if you want to be kept by the power of God for anything, it's through faith.
Amen. Amen.
And then if you look at the word salvation, salvation does not only mean eternity or eternal life or going to heaven. Salvation is the word soteria. The Greek word S-O-T-E-R-I-A, which refers to, yes, saving of the soul, but also saving of the body, saving of the mind, saving of the life, making a whole life. It means to be healed. It means to be saved. It means to be delivered. It means to be basically made whole.
Amen.
In every way.
Amen.
So Jesus secured our salvation. Yes, going to heaven. Yes, forgiveness of sins. Yes, saved from hell. But also saved from sickness, saved from disease, saved from mental oppression,
Amen.
Saved from lack and poverty, saved from anything that would injure your life and cause harm to you.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The only type of harm that God did not promise us protection from is persecution for righteousness' sake. And rather than protect us from that, He promised we would get that.
Yes.
So that's a promise from God. Everybody raise your hand and say, God, I receive persecution. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lord.
I rejoice.
Hey, it's part of the deal. If you're going to be a Christian, the Bible says everybody who lives godly is going to suffer persecution. So thank God for some persecution. It's part of the package. It means we're special. It means we're on the same playing field with Jesus. It means we're partners with our blood brother, Jesus Christ. So it all comes together. But we get the blessing and the persecution. That's the only harm that God promised you have to have.
Amen.
Right?
Hallelujah.
The rest of the harm you have salvation from.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
If you have faith to be kept by the power of God from it. So whatever sickness, disease, you can be kept by the power of God from it. Whatever destruction's happening to your life, you can be kept by the power of God. Go to sleep thinking I'm kept by the power of God. You don't have to pray when you go to sleep. Now lay me down to sleep, pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, pray the Lord my soul. You don't got to do that in some, you know, uncertain manner of I hope I get to. We already know those things.
Amen.
What you ought to be thinking is, I'm kept by the power of God tonight and every night. Yes. Praise the Lord. I'll have good dreams, sweet sleep, good sleep. I'm not anxious about tomorrow. I'm not anxious about my life. I'm not worried about anything. I'm kept by the power of God. I'm just coasting in the power of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's the way Christians are supposed to live. Unaffected, unmoved, unshaken by anything out there, because we know we're kept by the power of God. Whatever challenge is facing us, whatever obstacles come, whatever circumstance, whatever devil, whatever thing in the world is messing with us, whatever thoughts, whatever.
Amen.
The Christian's not supposed to be affected or moved by it at all. We're in our holy bubble. We're just kept by the power of God, and I'm just safe from anything. A thousand can fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand, but it shall not come near me. So, well, I'm sorry y'all didn't get the word in you. I've been trying to help you get the word, but you're falling left and right, but I'm okay. I know I'm going to be okay. I'm real sorry for you. I got the word for you. If you need help, come on. I'm ready to help you. If you're ready out of your mess, come on. But they're falling left and right, but it shall not come near us. So we're not afraid for arrows that flies by day, or the pestilence that walks in the darkness, or all the destruction that wastes at noonday.
Amen.
Just, yeah, they're falling, but I'm not worried at all.
Amen.
Every tower in the United States could fall, but it won't get me. I'll be one that I heard from God and I didn't go in. You just have to live this way. You have to believe this way. You have to get a mindset. When you go to bed and when you wake up, I'm kept by the power of God. Nothing can touch me. Even if I have to walk in a scary place, even I have to go out at night, even I have to, whatever, whoever you are, wherever you are, you're kept by the power of God.
Amen.
You have an angel of the Lord that's camped around about those that fear. And this is how you live. And so you're just different. We're just different people. We're kept by the power of God. Nothing can stop me. Not afraid of sickness and disease. It's under my feet. It has to stay under my feet. If it shows up, it made a very serious mistake, and I rebuke it and command it out. And you just reverse the curse, and you overcome the challenge, and you raise the dead, and oops, they died. Oh, they weren't supposed to. Let's fix that.
That's right.
Amen.
That's how you have to think. I mean, it's a different mindset that Peter and the apostles and Jesus had. People say, well, how come good Christians die? Well, in the Bible, Peter came up against somebody who died, and everybody said, oh, she's such a good person, you know. How come she, they're crying, she's such a good person, you know. I'm sure they're thinking, why would God let such a good Christian die? You ever thought that before? And Peter knew better. Peter knew that it didn't have to be that way.
Amen.
Good Christians aren't supposed to die early. So let's fix it. Peter just raised her from the dead. That was an accident. That was somebody made a mistake somewhere. Let's fix the mistake.
Yeah. Amen.
It's just a different way to think. It's a different way to live, that we are kept by the power of God if you believe. Through faith, through your belief. Not your belief just in the fact of Jesus, the Son of God, but the fact that all of what came with Jesus, the Son of God.
Amen.
You got to believe all of what came with Jesus' resurrection.
That's right.
Overcoming death, hell, and the grave. Overcoming sin, the world, and the devil. Overcome sickness. He overcame sickness and disease. I mean, he allowed all that to be put on him as an exchange, so we don't have to have it. You have to get that. You have to know all of what Jesus brought with his resurrection. And then verse 6 can come to pass for you. In this you greatly rejoice. Greatly rejoice, greatly rejoice, greatly rejoice. That's part of faith life, faith living, is you greatly rejoice about these things. You got to be real happy. I mean, you got to be real happy and excited about these things. And if you hadn't gone through that phase yet, you need to. If you hadn't gone through the phase of greatly rejoicing that I can be kept by the power of God.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, with so much that you, when you think about it, it just starts tickling you on the inside, right? It's got to get on the inside of you. You can't just hear the message and think, okay, well, I'm a Christian, so I'm safe. No. It's got to tickle you on the inside. Amen. It's got to light your candle.
Right.
And then you can rejoice greatly, though now for a little while, if need be, you've been grieved by various trials. that the genuineness or the trial of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it's tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We didn't say you wouldn't have trials. We just said you don't have to be moved by them. And so this is the trying of our faith. Whatever we encounter from the world could test our faith. Not that God gave us those tests, but that whatever we encounter, it can try my faith no problem. Amen. I'm secure in my faith.
Amen.
Some people hope and pray they don't have any trials. That's the person doesn't have any faith. If you have faith, you're not afraid of the trial. You have to expect them because trials are promised in this world.
That's right.
You just have to squash them. If you have a trial, it doesn't mean your faith was weak.
That's right.
Amen. Getting a trial doesn't prove anything.
Right.
It's what you do now.
That's right.
This is the moment where it's all tested by fire and you're going to step up and step up on top of it. Because that's more precious than gold that perishes. Notice that. The trial of your faith, the genuineness of your faith being much more precious than gold.
Amen.
Of course, it's in the analogy of gold being refined, gold being burnt with fire makes it pure. Smith Wigglesworth said that great faith is a result of great trials. Isn't that right? It's one thing to study how to lift weights. It's another to lift weights. So do it right. Learn how to do it right. You know, if you're going to be a weightlifter, you've got to learn how to the right techniques. Learn how to do it right. At the same time, get ready because you're going to have to lift some weights to be strong in faith. Look at verse 13. Says, gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober and rest your hope fully on the grace that's to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Notice that phrase, gird up the loins of your mind.
Yeah.
Gird up the loins of your mind. That means anchor your brain.
Yeah.
Clothe your mind. Gird up. Put your clothes on your mind.
Amen.
That refers to you knowing the truth. First, you having a renewed mind so that you can handle the mental realm. The fight of faith is where?
In the mind.
It's really in the mind. The battle is in the mind. Keeping yourself trusting God through a hard time, enduring is a huge mental battle.
Yes.
You understand? The fight of faith is nothing more than you convincing yourself that God will come through right in the face of circumstance.
That's right. Amen.
That's what the fight of faith is. It's convincing yourself and then staying convinced.
Yes. Amen.
That's what the fight of faith is. The fight to believe, the fight of faith, the fight of believing.
Mm-hmm.
If it was easy, everybody would do it.
That's right.
Getting miracles requires the fight of faith to be won.
Mm-hmm.
So to have a miracle, you've got to be fully convinced, totally persuaded.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. We read that in James.
Amen.
Unwavering. So gird up your mind. Get ready to win the thought war. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. Verse 7. Casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. It's part of your faith life. Have you learned this part yet? How many of you have cares of life? You don't have to raise your hand. I know you all do. Have you learned how to cast the cares over? I mean, I'm talking cast the care to where you don't feel the care anymore. I'm talking cast the care to where it doesn't bother you when you wake up. I'm talking really cast the care.
Amen.
Where the care's gone off of you.
Amen.
Cast the care.
Amen.
Cast the care. It doesn't say pet the care.
Come on.
That's how a lot of people wake up, petting their cares.
Amen.
That's how they go to bed, petting their cares. That's how a lot of people pray, is just petting their cares. Yes, I have all these worries and concerns. Who's going to worry if I don't? You have to learn. It's an art of faith. It's a principle of faith. It's an act of faith to learn how to cast cares to where they're off your shoulder, off your brain, off your mental capacity. Cast the care. You got this huge issue. You have to learn how to disconnect from it. Pray, request, cast it to God. You need to learn how to just say, God, I cast the care. I won't think about it all day long. I cast it. I cast it. I cast it. I cast it. I cast it to God. Okay, I'm casting it. Here I go. I'm casting it to God. I'm casting it to God. There. I think I just did it. I think I did it for real. Okay. Now, I'm not going to think about it all day, God. I'm not going to think about it anymore. And if I do, you yank me. Okay, so I cast it to you. I'm not thinking about it anymore. I cast it to you. Okay, I got it. Now, you got it, God? All right. All right. Now I'm free.
Amen.
Yeah, I feel free. Okay, I'm free. All right, I'm not going to worry. I'm not going to worry. I'm not going to worry. Won't worry about it. No, I won't worry about it. I won't worry about it anymore. There, 60 seconds, and I've convinced myself that I've cast the care.
Yes.
That's the fight of faith. That's a faith action that you have to do. You can't just pray and then have it nag at you all day.
Right.
That means you haven't really done the casting care.
Right.
Very important. Just real simple, but very important that you actually fight the fight.
Yep.
60 seconds, you can win the fight.
Amen.
You don't have to plan on a full month of worrying about a problem that you've prayed about.
Right.
Learn how to cast the care and cast the care. I'm casting it. Holy Spirit, remind me the rest of the day. If I start thinking about you, remind me what I did this morning. Get in a relationship with God about it.
Yes.
And if the rest of the day you think about it 1 or 2 or 10 times, thank you, Lord, I know you got it. Thank you, Lord, I know you got it. Not worried about it at all. I've cast the care. I've cast the care. God's a good caretaker.
That's right. Amen.
Verse 8, be sober. Be vigilant. What does that mean, be sober? Be in your right mind. Let your mind be alert to these things. Let your mind be alert to how the thoughts could come to rob you of your faith. Gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober in your mind. Have a right mind. Be sharp against the devil. Be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking all the doubters and the worriers.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I mean, in essence, seeking whom he may devour. Who can he devour? The doubters and the worriers.
That's right.
The fearful. The unlearned, the ignorant, those without knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
This is the answer for lives right here. This is the simple fight of faith for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 9, resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. Now he's referring to persecution, which you see Paul, or this wasn't Paul, this was Peter. All the apostles, really, that every time they referred to suffering and problems, it was always, you know, top on the list was persecution and suffering for Christ's sake. We're not real familiar with all that. Regardless, resist the devil steadfast in the faith. If he tries to make you lose faith, you resist him.
Amen.
If he tries to make you doubt, you resist him. If he tries to discourage you, you resist him. If you resist him, he will flee.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't resist him, he won't flee.
That's right.
If you truly resist him, he'll flee.
That's right.
And if he's not fleed, you didn't resist. If he's still bothering you every day, every moment, or whatever, you haven't resisted. Oh, no, I did. No, you didn't.
Mm-hmm.
But I did. No, you didn't. The Bible says if you did, he'd have fleed.
That's right.
Come on.
And then we could skip back to verse 5 and 6. And see one of the real links to this whole thing. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he would exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him. So there's an aspect of humbling yourself, not in some meek, I mean, not in some feeble way. Oh, I'm just humbled, you know. But in a way that's where you got yourself out of the way. You got yourself out of the picture. It's not about you. It's you're humbled to God. Humbled to God. All right. Turn to 2 Peter chapter 1 with me. 2 Peter chapter 1. The humble people get grace. He gives grace to the humble. He gives grace to the humble. Second Peter chapter 1, verse 5. For this, but also for this reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten he was cleansed from his old sins. What people are short-sighted? Those who didn't add anything to their faith. Okay? So let me just take a quick walk through this. Faith is a foundational aspect of your walk with God, and it's a very exciting aspect of your walk with God. All right? So faith toward God is a foundational principle of Christ according to Hebrews chapter 6. And a few other things, but that's part of the foundation. And it is absolutely essential for your life on earth and for your eternity is that you learn how to live by faith and you learn how to trust God and that all of your life is lived, the just shall live by faith.
That's right. Amen.
Okay? It's an aspect of learning, and so many Christians have never even been trained in the things of faith. How to really trust God, how to really know God's will, and then trust God to bring it to pass and stand on His Word, because all faith begins with the Word. Mm-hmm. To have faith in God has nothing to do with blind, nebulous faith. Oh, I just believe that God will. I just believe that God loves me. That's nice, but that's not Bible faith. Bible faith knows the will of God, believes the will of God, and sees the will of God come to pass.
Yes.
All right? It's very exciting when you first get into the kingdom of God, realize God actually will answer your prayer without you having to just toss 50,000 prayers up to see which one sticks. Well, God, if you'll heal me, then do that. And if you won't heal me, then, you know, at least let me keep one leg. And if I can't keep one leg, then, and you just pray all sorts of ways around it. And if you know, hopefully something will stick. Well, if you pray, you know, 50 different outcomes, well, something will probably stick. And then they say, well, God, look what God did. God didn't do anything. You just kind of bounced around the world and let the devil shove you around or the circumstance shove you around. So that's not faith at all. And so what we have to realize is very exciting when we learn God answers prayer and speaks to us. And we get excited about these things. And that's part of our maturity, our development in the Lord. But there's more to it, isn't there? I mean, everybody loves the miracle ministry. Where we all get wonderful, mighty things to happen. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Everybody loves to hear how God will answer your prayer for finances next week and how He will heal your body this week, and we might get to see somebody else get healed. Those are phenomenal things that are very essential in our growth. But that's not all there is to it. That's not all there is to discipleship.
Amen.
It amazes me how, well, it doesn't really amaze me. My heart kind of is sorrowful for Christians who get too focused on just one arena of God.
There you go.
Find a grand miracle ministry or healing ministry, and it's like, well, that they think that's the whole thing, and then they despise everything else and don't really want to grow, but they're excited about miracles. And I was excited about miracles too, but I was wise enough to recognize it was a part of my Christian walk, but not the entire Christian walk.
Amen.
And so you have to move on. It's wonderful to hear faith teaching, but in church, pastors can't just faith teach.
Amen.
Now, we do a lot of it here, and it's kind of interwoven in every aspect because it's very fundamental.
Right.
At the same time, you can't just teach on how to get your prayers answered.
Right.
It's not only about that. It's not only about how you can get victory over this world. That's part of it, but you should now be victorious.
Amen.
After a good 6 months of victory preaching, you ought to be victorious. At least you ought to see yourself victorious, and that's the first step to get victorious.
Amen.
So you have to move on. He says you got to add to your faith some of these other things. And if you don't, you're short-sighted and blind. So add to your faith virtue or excellence, to virtue, knowledge, to knowledge, self-control, to self-control, perseverance, perseverance, godliness, to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. Amen. Notice, I do like this, that love is at the end of the list. It is the badge of maturity. But to walk in love where you're not self-focused, you're not judgmental. And then the one right before it, I like brotherly kindness. To have brotherly kindness, you have to be around brothers.
That's good.
So those who don't have a family of God to be with, they've missed it. Sitting at home without any Christian fellowship, they've missed the list.
Amen.
So they're, like he said, short-sighted even to blindness.
That's
Peter
good.
Said that.
That's really
Peter.
Good.
Peter. Go to... Go to 1 John chapter 5. verse 4. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. All right, so you're born of God. Sure, you've overcome the world. Live from that place. And you can be over every world problem, world issue, world catastrophe, world attack, world government. Christians ought not be afraid of a one world government. Who gives a flip?
That's right. Come on.
Jesus is going to come rule this whole thing with us. And I don't care who we have to squash to make it happen.
That's right.
It just ain't happening yet until Jesus comes back to the earth. So until then, we're just going to wreak havoc on the devil and his worldly systems.
Amen.
You know, the devil is in charge of the whole world.
Yeah, that's right.
The Bible says the devil's the ruler of the world.
That's right.
The devil took Jesus on the mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world, said, they're mine, I'll give them to you if you bow. If he wasn't telling the truth, it wouldn't have been a real temptation. So the devil's in charge of the kingdoms of the world. I don't care if it's separate kingdoms or one world kingdom. I don't really care. The devil's in charge of that.
That's right.
And we're not taking that back from him until Jesus steps foot on the earth.
That's right.
Until then, I'm not afraid of nothing.
Amen.
So Christians don't have to be afraid of the Antichrist or the one world government or the United Nations or all the ridiculous, you know, country policies that are going around the world.
Amen.
There's always been world dictators. There's always been world terrorists. They'll have their place in the pit of hell.
Amen.
Okay? Our job is to save those who are open. We got to seek and save that which are lost. That's Jesus said, I've come to seek and save that those who are lost. Then he said, as my Father has sent me, I send you. What are you supposed to do? Seek and save those who are lost.
Amen.
Seek and save those who are lost. Seek and save those who are lost.
Amen.
For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. We've already overcome all this world garbage. You can turn on the nightly news. I'm sure none of you watch that. You've overcome that all. You've overcome all of the garbage that goes on in the city and the nation and Washington, D.C. You've overcome all of that. Hallelujah. We're not trying to overcome it. We've already overcome it. As the church, we're not losing any battle. As the church, we're not losing the battle against sin or immorality. We're not losing the battle. We've overcome everything already.
Yeah. That's good.
Now, if you're going to fight with the sword, you're going to have to. If you're going to live by the sword and fight with the sword, you're going to have to die by the sword.
Yeah.
Chew on that for a little while.
It's the truth.
Remember, Jesus said, "I could have done it. I could have called the armies of God. Right. I could have fought with the sword. I could have fought with the sword, but I didn't.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it's not a physical fight right now.
Amen.
Yes, that's right.
It's a spiritual fight to seek and save that, those who are lost.
Okay. Amen.
For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. So I've already overcome the world.
Amen.
I know you're thinking, why don't you read the next part? Well, because I'm stuck on this part. Pick anything in the world that you don't like, you've overcome it.
That's right.
Glory.
Maybe your situation at work, maybe the way your boss handled things, maybe the way your company policies have come through, maybe the healthcare system, maybe the financial system, you've overcome that. It doesn't have to beat you. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith.
Hallelujah.
What does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
The victory that overcomes the world is your belief system.
Amen. Glory.
Amen.
Glory.
You believe yourself on top of the world. You believe yourself a victor in spite of the economy.
Amen.
There'll be another economic problem coming one day. What are you going to do about it? Well, if I was you, I'd decide I'm keeping my job or getting a better one.
Amen.
I'm keeping income coming in somehow. I'm trusting my heavenly source.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
Trusting my heavenly Father who is my source.
Yes. That's
right.
So I'm not worried about it at all.
That's right.
He'll provide for me somehow.
Amen.
So I don't have to deplete my savings.
Yes.
Amen.
Always. Amen.
That's right.
Just decide it now.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
If you lose your job, no problem. Somebody made a mistake. Let's fix the mistake.
Amen.
You don't get discouraged. You don't have to bend over. You don't have to get
Amen. That's right.
I already said get discouraged. So this is the victory that overcomes the world. Our faith is the victory. Our faith is the victory. Some people don't want to hear any faith teaching. Listen, it's your faith that overcomes the world. Sure, in the broad scheme of things, your faith is going to get you out of here to avoid Armageddon.
Yes.
No.
And your faith is going to get you out of here to avoid the devil's havoc, the Antichrist rule, and your faith is going to get you away from hell.
That's right.
So you overcome everything by faith. You become victorious by faith.
Amen.
But on a smaller scale, you can pick anything of the world, anything of this life, that you need victory over. How are you going to get victory? By your belief system.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
And if you'll believe it 100%, you'll have a 100% miracle.
That's right.
Yeah.
If you believe it 50%, I have a quarter. You can flip it. Go to same chapter here, verse 13, or we'll read verse 11. This is a testimony. God's given us eternal life. This life is in His Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. Okay, so if you don't have the Son of God, who is Jesus Christ, you don't have life. You can be a good person. You can be born of a certain race. You do not have life without the Messiah, the Son of God.
Amen.
Then he says this, these things I've written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God that you may know that you have eternal life. Mm-hmm. How many of you believe in the Son of God? You can raise your hand this time. I can tell you beyond the shadow of a doubt, you have eternal life.
Glory.
Yes. Glory.
No hell for you.
Glory.
No whipping post for you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thanks, Lord.
Thank you,
no mass punishment in the earth for you.
Glory.
Notice that you may know you have eternal life.
Mm-hmm.
There's no wishing or hoping or trying.
Nope.
You know, the old testimony used to be, well, I'm just living my life trying to make heaven my home. There's no trying about it. It's a positive statement. This is a faith statement that you may know you have eternal life. In a general sense, for your eternal destination, you can know heaven is your home.
Amen.
You can know it. How do you know it? Because we got a bunch of stuff written, that's how. I wrote these things so you'd know.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
I wrote the Bible so you'd know. I wrote the scripture so you'd know. I had my men pen the scripture so you'd know.
Yes. Glory. Yes.
So you'd know. Of course, then you have the Holy Spirit witness inside you to know as well.
Amen.
We have a witness in our spirit that we are the sons of God. He bears witness with my spirit that I'm a son of God. I know it in here, and also I got it written. That's a faith statement. I wrote this so you could know. Well, let's apply it to anything. Anything that's written, you can know. If all my needs are met according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus, I know that.
Yes.
Therefore, I can have that.
Yes. Sure.
This is how faith works. It's written. I know it. Therefore, it comes to pass for me. Therefore, all my needs are always met.
Yes.
Therefore, I never have any lack ever. Since I got in the kingdom of God, never had any lack whatsoever.
That's right.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Actually, ever since I was 5 years old, because my parents knew some things. Never had any lack. Never had any lack. That means I always got to eat big juicy hamburgers when I wanted. I always had a car since I was 16 years old that ran well. Now back then I had to work on my own car. And I believed that I would never have to do that forever. Never had any lack. Because I know something. I learned Matthew 6 like you did. I learned Matthew 6 that I will never have to take a thought worrying about tomorrow. I know these things because they're written. Once you know them, you can have them. Once you know you're victorious, you're victorious. Once you see it, you got it.
Glory.
You can borrow information, but you can't borrow revelation.
That's right.
You can steal somebody's cute saying, but you can't steal the revelation behind the saying. So if you're going to use a saying, you better have the revelation of the saying, or it won't work for you.
That's right.
So secondhand revelation doesn't work.
That's right.
Now you can learn it from somebody else, but you got to take time to get it in your heart for your own self. Your own self.
Yes.
That's grammatically correct. For your own self. Or you could just say for yourself. For your own self. Own is emphasis. The Texas way. Let's get back in. Verse 14. Now this is the confidence that we have in Him. That if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have the petitions that we've asked of Him. That's a real simple statement. Some people read it with one eye open. And they concluded that this means when you pray, you're supposed to say, God, can I have the such and such if it be Thy will? If you open both eyes, you notice an extra word in there called according to His will. Not if it be Thy will, but according to His will. The word according adds a very important piece of the puzzle because the word according is only used to refer to something already previously established.
Right.
So I would say something like, according to my friend John, he's going to show up for lunch. According to the bank, they said that they would. According to the history book, you're referring to something someone already has said, done, or established. So you have to pray according to what God has already said, done, or established. That means His will is already secure. You just have to pray according to it. It doesn't mean you tack on if it be Thy will to every single prayer. Now, some prayers you need to put, if it be Thy will. Jesus used it one time. It's called the prayer of consecration. It's when you don't know for sure the will of God, or you just want to discuss the will of God with God, and you say, God, now, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, Your will. So He's relinquishing His own desire to the will of God. That would be consecrating my will to the will of God. Sometimes you pray that, like, God, I sure like this guy, but I only want to marry if it's your will. So if it's your will, I'd like to marry him. And if he says no, then don't marry him.
Amen.
But I like him. No.
Amen.
But he's cool. No. But he's a Christian. No. But he's a non-Christian. No. God has a say-so in life choices.
Amen.
So you have to get faith for every life choice as well. Well, God, I want to be a fireman. No. You have to find when God's going to say yes. Not that I'm not saying fire being a fireman is bad. I'm just saying God may say no. God, I want to move here. He may say no. God, I want to do that. He may say no. There's life choices that he may say no to, and those are the times you say, if it be thy will. But health and having your needs met and victory over world problems and mental issues and depression and all those things aren't life choices. Those are covenant promises. For all those things, all the promises of God are yes and amen. God, I want to be healed. Yes. God, I need some money. Yes. God, I want to be victorious. Yes. God, I need some joy. Yes. God, I need some peace. Yes. Those are things you don't have to ask God's will about. You understand? So here he says, here's the confidence you can have that if you ask according to his will. So what's his will? His will is his word. If I told you we're starting at 7 o'clock tonight, we're starting at 7 o'clock tonight. How do you know? Because I said so. Therefore, you can show up and sit down and expect 7 o'clock music begins.
Yes.
How did you do that? Why did you show up on time knowing? Because you heard me, you knew the schedule, you had faith, but not blind faith. You had a reason to believe, and you did it.
Right.
That's faith. Faith is knowing and then showing up. Faith is believing. This is the confidence that if we ask anything according to his will is his word. How do you know what I want? I would have to have said it.
Right.
Same thing with God. So if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. That implies that if you don't ask according to God's written word or according to his will in things not written, he won't hear you. Doesn't it imply that?
Yes.
Doesn't explicitly say that, but it says if we ask anything according to his will, then he hears us.
Yes.
That implies that people say, well, God hears everything. He doesn't hear your old doubtful prayers.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
He could. He's omnipotent and omniscient. He could. But I have a feeling that God doesn't want to hear all your grumbling. So he can turn you, he can tune you out, just like your husband. Your wife. I think God has the ability not to hear all the garbage that people are saying. He doesn't want to clutter his mind either.
That's right. That's good.
Remember, there's scriptures in the Bible that talks about the prayers have come before me. That the angels deliver the prayers to God. I think there's a system that we don't even aware of where God is very intimate with us and knows everything about us. At the same time, there's some system of which prayers get heard. But for us who know the truth, we know that he hears all of our prayers. If you ask according to his word, he hears you.
Thank you, Lord.
Now what you need to recognize is since he has heard you, you got it. See, the goal is not to convince God of something. The goal is to get him to hear you. And if he hears you, you got it. I didn't make this stuff up. I'm not making this up. This is not me, man. I did not make this up. I would not have designed it this way.
Glory to God.
I would have figured out a different way.
Thank you, Lord. Glory to God.
Verse 15, if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have the petition we asked of him.
Yes.
So if he, all I got to do is get him to hear me, because if I know he heard me, I got it.
That's right.
I find myself in prayer many times. talking about things over and over again, talking to God about things over and over again, even sometimes asking over and over again. Yeah. Now, I know that part of the faith principle is not to re-ask and re-ask and re-ask, but I say re-ask until you know He heard you.
Amen. Yeah.
You can sense it. You can know it. And so that's why you find yourself sometimes asking more than you should, because you didn't put any faith in, did He hear me the first time? Or the 10th time? So put your faith into, do I sense Him hearing me? Am I getting through? Do I feel like my faith is reaching the throne? And if you feel like it, then He heard you. If you sense in your spirit He's hearing you, you can walk off praising God. He heard me. He heard me. I got it. He heard me. He heard me. That's all I got to get Him to do is hear me. All I got to do is make sure He heard me. And then I got the petitions I desired of Him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, the bumper sticker that goes around Houston, it says, God listens. They need a little disclaimer at the bottom. Only to those who ask according to His word. Some people take a lot of solace knowing that God knows what they're going through. And He does. And there is great, we've done messages on that. It's great solace to know He knows the feeling of our infirmities. Jesus was tempted in all points like we are. He's been through this earth life. He knows what it means to be a human in this old dirt. So we take solace knowing that God's with us and He understands how I'm feeling. But you got to go further than that. To get a prayer answer, you got to go further than that. So knowing that God's listening is not enough for those who need miracles.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
Hallelujah. All right, I think we can finish. Tonight, I mean. Turn a page to go to 2 John. This is such an interesting letter. And I want to read it even though it's not necessarily got the word, I don't think it has the word faith in it, but I want you to see this because it is an aspect of our living by faith is you got to walk in love. Living by faith means you got to walk in love. And if you have all these things and faith and moving mountains and miracles and all this prophesying and stuff, but you don't have love, well, you're nothing. You're just kind of, ugh, people run from you. Now, he's writing, verse 1, to the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but all those who have known the truth. And then he says, verse 4, I rejoice greatly that I found some of your children. I think this lady was probably a pastor or some leader of the church. I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in truth as we received commandment from the Father. And now I plead with you, lady, not as though I write a new commandment to you, but that which we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. Notice that he says, I plead with you that we love one another. It's almost like this is a letter of correction in love. Something had happened, and he's pleading that we love one another. I have found myself as a pastor doing the same thing many times. Trying to make up with someone, trying to get to the table, trying to, let's love one. Oh, no, no, there's no need for animosity. There's no need to be offended at me. No, 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 I plead with you that we love one another. Verse 6, this is love, that we walk according to His commandments. This is the commandment, as you have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. Notice how he's trying to bring some correction. Then he goes on and kind of alludes to maybe what has happened. Many deceivers have gone out into the world who do not confess Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. And then he goes on and says some other things. We don't have to go through it. You can read it for yourself. But I just want you to see that something had gone on, and he's just pleading that we love one another. Part of your faith life, if you're going to be a developed, mature Christian, you're going to have to get to a place of walking in love with your fellow man, walking in brotherly love, being able to forgive one another and stay together. Being able to forgive one another and stay together. You don't get your feelings hurt and then run off. We're family. This is family stuff. This is people that know the truth. They don't get offended and disappear.
That's good.
They don't get disrespected and disappear. Think about a natural family. A good natural family will have some disrespect every once in a while. Isn't that true? There's dishonor even in natural families. They don't just disappear. Right? Because natural families tight. They'll put up with each other's garbage, won't they? For some reason, we all come to church thinking that, you know, people owe us everything, and then we get our feelings hurt and run off.
Amen.
How about being tough? How about being committed to one another? How about recognizing we all got some faults?
Amen.
I plead with you that we love one another.
Amen.
So you're not allowed to leave Houston Faith Church offended.
Amen.
You're not allowed. You may need to go. God may have something for you. He may have a new season, but you're not allowed to leave because you're disgruntled, upset, mad at somebody,
amen,
disappointed, discouraged, or offended.
Amen.
That's good.
That's good teach.
Amen. You signed a piece of paper saying you would never. Didn't y'all sign a piece of paper saying you would never? It's part of the faith walk. The love walk is part of the faith walk. Faith worketh by love. So it all goes together. 3 John, verse 2, you know the scripture. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospers. Just note the soul part. You know, there's something in your mental realm that has to prosper. You know, we've just never seen a sad faith person. Your soul has to get happy before miracles happen. All right? You're not even in faith until you get happy. Your soul has to prosper. You have to be stable mentally. You have to have your emotions in check. You have to have your loins of your mind girded. Make sense? Your soul has to prosper. You have to be legitimate with God. You have to be secure in your belief. And when you're secure in your belief, it'll discipline your brain for you. Jude chapter 1. Verse 3. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. Notice the term, contend earnestly for the faith. What's he talking about? Apparently, by the time Jude wrote his letter here, the Christian church had lost something. Apparently, by the time Jude wrote this letter, the Christian church had lost some of their faith. They began to doubt. They began to disregard. Their lifestyle showed it, maybe. Their lack of miracles showed it. Their lack of love walk showed it. Their lack of following the commandment showed it. Something showed it, because he's writing and telling them to earnestly contend for what faith? That was first delivered to the saints. So there's some early church faith you guys need. There's some early church faith we all need. So go study the early church. Get that faith. That's what he's talking about. He has to be talking about that. Mm-hmm. That was the first record of anything. It was the early church. We need to go get some early church faith. I don't know about you, but when I came into the kingdom, I didn't have any church history in me, really. I'd been to church a few times, didn't have any church history, didn't have any church tradition. And I said, I don't know how church is really supposed to be done, because I don't think we can trust these guys who don't have the Holy Spirit. And I don't know about these others either, because who would know? Who would know? I said, I'm going to go to the Bible, find out how church is supposed to be, how Christians supposed to look, and what's supposed to really happen with walking with God. So I went to the book of Acts and saw all this stuff happening. I saw people baptizing believers. I saw people leading people to Jesus. I saw people praying for the sick and they got healed instantly. People getting filled with the Spirit. I saw mighty things happen with thousands. I saw mighty things happen with ones and twelves. I saw all this fellowshipping, all this loving, all this eating together, all this putting all their belongings together and having a family. I saw all this wonderful, holy things happening. I thought, that's what we want. That's what church ought to be like. There's not a whole lot going on like that. Now there is. I mean, now we see it in small pockets here and there. We're trying to keep Houston Faith Church this way, where we have the faith of the early church.
Amen.
If a demon's present, we get the devil out. Without doing weird stuff. They didn't do weird stuff in the book of Acts to get devils out. They didn't have to have a cross. They didn't have to sprinkle water. They didn't have to make people barf in bags. Some of you don't even know what I'm talking about, but people done weird stuff to get devils out. Creating all this wrong doctrine, false doctrine. Just get it from the book of Acts. Do it like they did it. Say in the name of Jesus Christ, come out, make it come out. And if it didn't come out, it's probably because you didn't have enough faith. You ought to earnestly contend for that faith rather than your superstitious faith.
Amen.
People put a lot of faith in superstition, a lot of faith in doing rigmarole to get God to move. You don't see rigmarole done superstitiously to get God to move in the New Testament. But humans that don't have great success at certain things, they come up with human means. Physical, visible, you know, I got to do something on the outside to make something happen. No, you got to have some faith to make something happen. So contend for it. Notice, contend earnestly for faith. That means you as a believer take this and say, I'm going to contend for the early church type of faith. If you've never led someone to Jesus, contend for enough faith and courage to do it. If you haven't had the courage to share your faith, contend for that faith. If you haven't ever prayed for a sick person, seen them instantly healed, contend for that faith. If you haven't ever seen a devil manifest, or if you've never cast a devil out, contend for that faith. Ask God, give me some devils.
Amen.
You know what I meant. Come on, you know what I meant. Didn't you know what I mean? I don't mean give me devils. I mean, Let me have an opportunity to get a devil out of somebody. Let me have an opportunity to help somebody. Come on, you know what I meant.
Amen.
Jude, verse 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ and eternal life. Notice verse 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. A couple ways to look at it. I like it this way. That your most holy faith is praying in the Holy Spirit. One of the most holy things you can do is praying in the Spirit. Okay? That's how you get built up, if you'll pray in tongues. Praying in the Spirit is praying in tongues. Some people disagree with that, but if you read technical scripture, you'll see that Paul said, I will pray with the Spirit, or in the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. Either you pray with understanding, what does that mean? It means you understand what you're saying. Mm-hmm. Or you pray with the Spirit, which means you don't understand.
Right. Yeah.
Paul said, I'll do both. Mm-hmm. So when you pray with the Spirit or in the Spirit, you're praying in other tongues that you don't understand.
Right.
So praying in the Spirit, praying with the Spirit, praying in tongues, all the same thing. So build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in tongues.
Amen.
Okay?
Yes.
So if you want to be built up in faith, pray in tongues. If your faith's a little weak, read the Bible, get some word in you, and pray in tongues. So it can get charged, ready to act.
Amen.
And in doing so, you'll also keep yourselves in the love of God. Building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. So we're going to have strong faith around here.
Yes.
Come on, everybody wants a little bit stronger faith.
Yes.
I even want it. Come on, I want stronger faith. I want stronger faith. What do I got to do? I got to pray in the Spirit.
Yeah.
I want stronger faith. I want to see more things. I want to have more contact with the power of God. Amen. What do you got to do? Pray in tongues. Ask according to His will. Get less double-minded. Be more confident. Be more certain. Talk to God about it. Meditate on these things. How's your faith going to grow? You're going to have to talk to God about it. You're going to have to create some intimacy around this with God. Jesus spent time alone with God, and then he came out and did great things. And then he would go back to God, spend some more time with God, and come out and do great things. He'd minister all day, then he'd go fast all night. Not that we have to do that every night, but why not once? And then he would go do great things. So there's a relationship with God that's required for faith. Okay, this is not just something that accidentally happens. It's not just something you walk out saying, I want to do that. Okay, good. Then you're going to have to go through the process of hooking up with God in an intimate manner so that you can hear his voice, move when he moves, say what he says, and do what he does. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for the preaching of God's Word. We trust that your faith and your love for God is stronger than ever before. Chaz and Joni Stevenson have a New Testament vision of spreading the full gospel of Christ around the world, helping unbelievers meet Jesus Christ, and building strong Christians who can impact their world, and are doing so by preaching the uncompromised Word of God with the power of the Holy Spirit. To join us in that vision, please consider an offering to help with media costs, or an offering to simply show the value of the spiritual things you have received. You may give online, by mail, or by phoning in with a credit card. If you're in Houston, Texas, and looking for a good home church, Pastors Chaz and Joni invite you to a Spirit-filled, life-changing service at Houston Faith Church, where we're certain you'll experience the love and goodness of God in a real and powerful way. For more information about God, Houston Faith Church, or Stevenson Ministries, please visit us on the web, where you can now watch services via live streaming and find many other life-changing resources, or download our Houston Faith phone app.